I heard Donald Trump in the primary again, and to me that's a good thing. In the primary, Donald Trump gave more interviews to hostile news organizations, friendly news organizations. He ran the gamut, giving interviews to everyone. He wasn't afraid of press conferences. He wasn't afraid to field the hard questions. And I loved that about, at that time, candidate Trump, that he was open and willing to address anything. And I think it was brilliant of him today to come in and say, get me in front of that microphone, let me answer about this Flynn controversy. I think he received some blowback yesterday when he only fielded questions from friendly reporters. And today, to have this stark contrast, to have the President Trump, who I know was transparent during the primary and open, to have that President Trump back, I think is a winning strategy going forward.
I love hearing your opinion, but I just have to push you on this one teeny tiny thing, which is when he came out initially and said, I've had the biggest electoral win since Ronald Reagan, which is false. And guys, throw the graphic up again, and you can see the Clinton, Obama, and H.W. Bush all surpassed his numbers. And so when he was pressed later by Peter Alexander over at NBC, he was essentially like, Mr. President, how can the public trust you when you're giving the public bad, wrong, erroneous information? How would you answer that, Kaylee?
Look, I think it was very good that he did not follow in that incorrect line of, you know, I guess, information when it was presented to him. I think sometimes he hears information, like, for instance, he did have a historic victory in winning Michigan, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, states not won by any Republican since Reagan. That's an accurate fact, but I think sometimes he hears that and perhaps, you know, gets it wrong or messes up on the nuance or the specificity of the fact when he presents it. I don't think it's an intentional
lie. He was given the information, and that's what he read.
Sure, sure, and I think that he got it wrong, and I think the admitted that and he didn't continue down that line of information was a very good thing.
Okay. Anna Navarro, what say you?
I think we just saw brilliance in action. You know what the guy did right now? He gave us a 1-hour and 15-minute performance to distract us. And he did. In fact, he knew he was doing it to a level that he even told us, I'm gonna go watch TV and there's gonna be people saying that I was ranting and I was raving and I was unhinged. He was performing. We're talking about the Electoral College vote again. You know what we're not talking about? The explosive report from yesterday that there were campaign aides of his allegedly colluding with Russia.
Oh, yes, we have,
But what we're concentrating on is unpacking the whiplash that we've all just suffered from watching this hour and 15 minutes, right? The Electoral College. Look, Brooke, he's always going to be the guy that tells you, I caught a fish this big, even if it was a minnow. This is just who he is. And he knows that we chase it. We chase those shiny objects. He baited us. He told us this was going to be a press conference about his new labor secretary. Who? That guy wasn't even there. He's a wonderful human being whom I know, Alex Acosta. But Donald Trump at one point even seemed to struggle with remembering his first name when he was joking with Jim Acosta about whether they were related or not.
And Alex Acosta.
So, you know, he got us there under that pretense, and then for an hour and 15 minutes, he played us like a fine-tuned violin and is distracting us. He's practicing for his rally tomorrow. He rehashed the campaign over and over again. He was fascinating at times. He was comical at others. He was terrifying at others. We just saw a 1-hour, 15-minute episode of the latest reality show of Trump's presidency.
I want you to jump in. The reason I was going to jump in
is because if the president was trying to distract us, I don't think he succeeded. Because the journalists in the room from NBC and CBS and ABC and the other networks were asking tough questions about Russia and about Flynn, I don't think he succeeded. I think the headlines tomorrow morning and the headlines right now are about Russia. But the through line of this was popularity. And I totally agree with you, Anna. This was a warm-up for Saturday's rally, this Saturday afternoon rally in Florida. Trump talked about his ratings. He talked about his poll numbers and his Electoral College victory. And the through line, all of that, is popularity. He wants to feel that popularity he felt in September and October before Election Day. And so he's going back, as Kaylee said, to the primary press conferences and to his general election rallies.
He also said,
and there's no doubt that this was, there was a level of, it was fascinating to watch because there's no doubt there was a level of catharsis, therapy to this. You know, some of us have to go and
pay a therapist. Who was it a catharsis for?
This guy can use that. Instead of going to a therapist's couch, he goes in front of the presidential seal and gives this performance. And that's
for
an hour plus.
Anna, I don't think it was about performing, though. I think for President Trump, he's heard these stories, many of which we have a gap in the facts. None of us have seen the Flynn transcript, for instance.
Correct.
None of us know who, if there was anyone on the campaign who contacted, who these people are. We actually do know Manafort was one of the people listed, but we don't know the content of those communications, whether it was with regard to business or President Trump. So for President Trump, it wasn't about performing. It was about supplementing the record. He has seen the transcript. He does know, at least in his knowledge, whether people communicated from the campaign or not. So to supplement the record, I think, was really important for him, and I think that was the catharsis, if anything.
And I think
I'll tell you why it was performance. It was performance because he never lost his cool. It was uncanny to see the fun he was having. This was a very good actor, a very good TV producer, a very good TV guy, savvy TV guy, doing his thing.
Does that make for a good, let me ask, does that make then an actor, a savvy TV producer, does that make for a solid president?
Some people will say yes, some people will say no. The people that say yes, there's nothing he can do for them to change his mind. The people that say no, there's little he can do to change our minds.
Maeve, go ahead.
That's the president that the American people elected. And to Kaylee's point, I mean, I would much rather have him up there answering the questions that he did today and at least giving us a window into his thinking on all of these issues. There were, there were some substantive issues that were talked about there. For example, his reaction to the court order and how he was having his lawyers tailor his executive order to the court decision, even though he thinks it's a bad court decision. He gave us some clues into his thinking on DACA. You mentioned that earlier. I thought that was one of the most interesting parts of the press conference because it tells us that he's thinking about what he's going to do on immigration, and maybe there'll be some surprises there. So the more that we can get a window into his mind and into his thinking, I think the better off the press is.
I think it's worth just, again, he said on DACA, I will deal with DACA with my heart. It's tough, especially with children, as Maeve pointed out, also on Russia and the executive action to be announced next week to be tailor ordered to the court decision. Mike Baker, former CIA, listen, you're listening to all of this on tone, performance, substance. What do you think?
I think I got nothing. I'm like everybody else just trying to process the press conference. So this may be way outside my pay grade. I can talk about in terms of the leak issue and Mike Flynn and where that's going. Yeah, I mean, exactly. But in looking at just his conversations and the questions that were asked about the leaks, for example, look, every administration essentially is the same. This one is, okay, admittedly more interesting or entertaining, whatever word you want to use. But administrations love the leaks when they fall on their side and they support their agenda, and they, are angst and driven to find the leakers when they go against their agenda. In the previous administration with President Obama, same thing, and all back through the ages. The fact that they're looking at and investigating the leaks related to General Flynn, my colleagues here said this the exact right thing. It's not going to stop the leaks. It's not going to, we're going to continue to see this, particularly now that I think whoever is responsible for releasing that information, and it was wrong to do it, and I don't know whether it came from the intel community or it came from staffers somewhere on the Hill or somebody who had access, and that's limited access. But at the end of the day, they're emboldened now. Because they saw the result. And so I think we're going to see an increase in this sort of trouble. And the problem has been that over the years, we've never really dealt with this. I don't want to get in the weeds of how we've dealt with past leaks, but we're almost living in a society now where there's no consequence. You know, nobody feels they should keep their yap shut despite agreements that they've signed. And now you have newspapers printing front page stories based on nothing but anonymous leaks. So I guess, to wrap this rambling message up that I've got, I would caution people to kind of drift themselves towards the center. We're in a moment right now where we're all going to exhaust ourselves over the hyper panic on the left side over the fact that Trump is president, and on the right side, the fact that, perspective, he can't get a break because everybody's beating on him every day. Mm-hmm. We're going to just be exactly